Good morning and welcome to the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee. A great pleasure to have you with us if you're joining us this morning. Our first agenda item is a declaration of interest following the resignation from the committee of Carol Mochan, who was only with us for a short time, I'm sorry to say, but very much appreciated Carol Mochan's contribution and her valuable insights to the work of the committee during her time with us. And I have pleasure in welcoming to the committee in her place Faisal Chowdhury, MSP. And the first item of business this morning is to invite Mr. Chowdhury to declare any relevant interests.
No, I don't have any. Thank you very much.
OK, thank you. So any interests you have are as in your register of interests?
No.
Yeah.
Nothing to do with the petition.
Okay. Agenda item two is the consideration of continued petitions. The first of those is petition number 1887 to create an Unborn Victims of Violence Act, lodged by Nicola Murray, and the petition calls upon the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to create an Unborn Victims of Violence Act, creating a specific offence that enables courts to hand down longer sentences for perpetrators of domestic violence which causes a miscarriage. Now, at our previous consideration of this petition on November the 23rd last year, we heard evidence from the petitioner, Nicola Murray herself, and key stakeholders. And the committee agreed to recommend that the Scottish Government create a specific statutory offence and or aggravator for causing miscarriage through acts of domestic violence. We also recommended that in its forthcoming report on the provisions of Domestic Abuse Scotland Act 2018, the Scottish Government should include a review and evaluation of the effectiveness of the current legal framework in bringing forward and prosecuting charges where miscarriage is caused. Now, the committee also wrote to the Scottish Sentencing Council requesting that the evidence gathered be taken into account as part of the Council's development of sentencing guidelines. And we've since had confirmation from the SCC that it will consider the committee's evidence as part of its work. The then Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans' response said that he would take time to fully consider the implications of any proposed changes before considering any next steps, including the potential for wider consultation. And he said that officials were already exploring potential policy options and that he would welcome meeting with the petitioner once that work is concluded. The Cabinet Secretary's response refers to a recent report on the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act 2018, but notes that it does not include a review of the effectiveness of the current framework in bringing forward and prosecuting charges where miscarriage is caused. So a little bit of work has taken place and has been forthcoming in the wake of the evidence we took from Nicola Murray. Do you have members have any questions or comments or suggestions that we might consider in relation to this? David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would agree, and we could find time in the busy schedule for the Parliament, that we take it to a chamber debate to raise issues raised in the petition.
Are we agreed with that suggestion? I think we are. I understand, having investigated this speculatively, it could be later in the autumn before that opportunity arises, which I suppose would also allow us the opportunity just to pursue any outcomes that might be forthcoming from the ongoing investigations so that we have all of that information before us at the time of the debate. But we are agreed. We are. We move then to petition number 1928, which is to provide free rail travel for disabled people who meet the qualifications for free bus travel. And this has been lodged by David Gallant. It calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide free rail travel for disabled people who meet the qualifications for free bus travel. And we last considered this petition in December on the 21st last year, when we heard evidence then from the petitioner and Cite Scotland, and we agreed to write to the Scottish Government. And at the time, we agreed to wait until responses had been received from those local authorities who offered discount fares for companion travel before writing to the Scottish Government. And I'm pleased to say we have now received responses from Strathclyde Partnership for Transport, West Lothian Council and Fife Council. And these responses highlight the financial pressures faced in operating the existing concessionary fares travel scheme. Now, with West Lothian Council actually removing their rail concession scheme as part of their own budget-saving measures. The committee previously agreed to write to the Scottish Government to ask what consideration it is giving to introducing a national policy for companion rail travel. You may recall that there were issues depending upon where you accessed and alighted from trains, and to ask it to confirm that the fares review will consider fee travel for companions and people with disabilities. Now, we've also received a submission from the petitioner ahead of this morning, who did not feel that the local authority responses were relevant to the aims of his petition, and suggested that free rail travel for disabled people could be restricted to specific routes or localities in order to benefit those living in more rural areas. In light of the responses we've received, do members have any comments or suggestions in relation to this petition that we might consider for further action? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee could write to Scottish Government, as previously agreed, to ask what consideration has been given to introduction of a national policy for companion rail travel, and to seek confirmation that the fares review will consider the option of extending a national entitlement card scheme to provide free rail as well as bus travel for people with disabilities.
Colleagues, are we content? Alexander Stewart?
I also think that it would be, you know, we did get information from some councils, convener, and I think that was useful to have. And the committee may want to highlight the responses that we did receive from West Lothian Council and Fife Council in that correspondence, because, as I say, that was something that did have an impact as well.
Okay.
But I'd be content with what David Torrance is suggesting as well.
Right, so we're generally content with the proposals that have been made, and we are. Petition number 1933, an important petition for the committee to allow the Forneti survivors to access Scotland's redress scheme, lodged by Iris Tinto on behalf of the Forneti Survivors Group, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to widen access to Scotland's redress scheme to allow Forneti survivors to seek redress. Now, we previously considered this petition at our meeting on the 23rd of November, and we agreed to write to the Scottish Government setting out the evidence we have gathered and specifically recommending that action be taken to widen the current eligibility criteria of Scotland's redress scheme to ensure that victims of the same type of crime committed over shorter time periods and in different care settings are eligible for redress under the scheme. The committee received a response from the then Deputy First Minister John Swinney, which indicated that work was underway to test the existing eligibility criteria and guidance in relation to Forneti, and that we would receive a further update when this analysis was completed. Now, we've also received a submission from the petitioner concerned that the matter might disappear into the long grass as a result of the recent changes in government. And the petitioner's submission also requests clarification on the cut-off date for a person in care scheme seeking to access the redress scheme. Fergus Ewing.
Yes, I wonder if we might invite the Deputy First Minister to give evidence at a future meeting. And perhaps I could also just add that, I mean, I think there's been quite strong feelings expressed across the parties by various MSPs on this issue, and time is marching on, and the petition is quite old, and I think the sooner the Deputy First Minister could give evidence, the better, out of consideration of the additional pain being caused to the petition, to those impacted by the continuing delay and uncertainty. So I just add that caveat.
Any other suggestions? No. Can I suggest, just for the avoid... David?
Okay, on you go.
No?
No,
I was going to simply say, can I suggest that just in case, for whatever reason, the Deputy First Minister is not familiar with all the issues, that we just maybe restate some of what we said in the previous letter to the Deputy First Minister and also the response we received at that time, just as the caveat underpinning why we're now seeking to meet with the Deputy First Minister herself. Agreed? David, is there anything you wanted to add to that?
No.
We're all content. We are. Petition number 1945 to ban the extraction and use of peat for horticulture and all growing media by 2023, lodged by Elizabeth Otway, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to place a legal ban on the extraction of peat imports, exports and sales in order to protect peatlands both in Scotland and worldwide. Now, the Scottish Government's submission from November last year highlights that the revised draft National Planning Framework 4, MPF4, prohibits new commercial peat extraction except in limited circumstances. Since that, the Scottish Government since then the Scottish Government submission was received, since that Scottish Government submission was received, MPF4 has now been approved. Now, in its submission, the Scottish Government said it had been working with the industry to understand transitional issues and that a consultation to remove peat from Scottish horticulture was expected to begin in December 22. However, it would not be possible to implement a sales ban by 23. The submission said that a delivery plan and timetable for phasing out horticultural peat would be developed after the consultation responses had been analysed and discussions with industry and environmental NGOs had taken place. The Scottish Government consultation was in fact launched in February and closes shortly on the 12th of May. The Scottish Crofting Federation in its submission urges the Scottish Government to restrict any ban on peat to horticultural sales and imports and the commercial extraction of peat for burning, while protecting the traditional rights of crofters to extract peat on a small scale for personal use. Do members have any questions or comments in relation to this one? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I think it's important that we write to the Scottish Government seeking a summary of the responses that they've had to date from their consultation and an update on when the delivery plan for timescale for phasing out horticultural peat will be developed and produced in light of the responses to that consultation, and also information on whether the government support a legal ban on the import, sale and use of peat of horticultural and commercial extraction of peat for burning, with the exception of crofters' traditional and cultural use.
Okay, any other colleagues want to comment? Fergus Ewing.
Yeah, just to say I was very pleased that the Crofters Federation did emphasise the importance of exempting from any ban, should it take place, of the traditional practice of burning peat for domestic use on a small scale, which is part of the history and culture of the Western Isles. And I'm sure there would be threats of direct action were people to extend the ban, and I would certainly be there manning the barricades, having developed recently a taste for direct action, Convener.
Well, ripping the sod, basically, you would to extend your current penchant for ripping into things. Just out of interest, Mr. Ewing, given your own experience, is this traditionally from their own land, or where would they? I mean, where do crofters tend to, for domestic use, take the peat from?
I think this is a sort of community effort, and that it's done by usually more than one person, right, and in a particular way. And so I think it's the community land that's used by and large, not individual. But I'm not sure. I'm no expert on that. But
okay, thank you very much for that. Colleagues, are we content with the suggestions that have been made?
Agreed.
We are. Petition number 1946, to call on the Scottish Government to pay all charges for homeless temporary accommodation. This is lodged by Sean Clarkin, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to use general taxation to pay for all charges for homeless temporary accommodation, including writing off the £33.3 million debt owed by homeless people for temporary accommodation to local authorities. Now, since our previous consideration of the petition, the Scottish Government's Temporary Accommodation Task and Finish Group published its report on the 30th of March this year. The group made two recommendations about charges for temporary accommodation, which are available in the clerk's note to you. The response to our recent correspondence with the Scottish Government states that provisions to prohibit local authorities from charging individuals for the provision of temporary accommodation have not been considered for inclusion in the Housing Bill. The Scottish Government has stated that it has no plans to pay for homeless temporary accommodation nor waive the outstanding debt owed. Now, Shelter Scotland's written submission outlines a number of issues, including its view that a change in the financing of temporary accommodation is overdue. The petitioner's recent submissions highlight concerns about the repossession of family homes, resulting in record amounts of homelessness in Scotland, and his submission outlines information received through an FOI to Glasgow City Council. He states that the system is unworkable and broken now, and meaning that thousands of people need help immediately, and I again invite colleagues to suggest any way in which we might proceed. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee could write to the Scottish Government seeking confirmation of its planned work in response to a temporary accommodation task and finish group's report. in particular if the committee would ask about recommendations 14 and 15 as they relate to temporary accommodation charges.
Thank you, Mr. Torrance. And colleagues, do we have any other suggestions, or are we content to proceed writing to the Scottish Government as Mr. Torrance has suggested? We are, then. Thank you very much. Petition number 1949, review the rules concerning dual mandate MSPs. And this has been lodged by Alexander James Dixon, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review the rules regarding dual mandate MSPs and legislate to bring them in line with the Synod and Stormont by preventing MSPs from holding a dual mandate in time for the next Scottish Parliament elections. We previously considered this petition on the 9th of November, when we agreed to write to the Welsh Parliament, the Northern Ireland Assembly and the Electoral Reform Society. And at our last consideration, we also noted the Scottish Government's view that this would actually be a matter for Parliament to consider. Having now received responses from our colleagues in other devolved institutions, members will have noted that legislation to prevent members of the Northern Ireland Assembly from simultaneously being a member of the UK House of Commons or the lower house of the Irish Parliament was brought forward by the UK government, while similar legislation in Wales was introduced by the Senate Commission, that is the equivalent of the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body. It appears that if the Scottish Government has no appetite to pursue this matter, we should consider what options are available to Parliament to give the matter further consideration. Although I always do observe that ministers hold a dual mandate as well, in that they have a second responsibility over that of being an MSP. Do colleagues have any suggestions? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I think that under this circumstance, it would be better for us to refer the petition to the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee, because they would have a more opportunity to look into and investigate rather than we at this, and that may extend and give more information. So under Rule 15.6 of Standing Orders, for further consideration, so I would suggest that we hand it to them and ask them to take further action on it.
Okay. Agreed. And may I just in the process obviously state for the record that I am a member of the Scottish Parliament Corporate Body, although in this instance the recommendation is to send it to a different committee. Thank you. Petition number 1971, to take robust action to stop motorcycle theft, lodged by Kenneth Clayton, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to help prevent and reduce motorcycle theft by empowering police to pursue and tactically engage thieves and reviewing sentencing policy to allow the courts to implement tougher punishment for those convicted of motorcycle theft, including the use of mandatory custodial sentences for those carrying weapons or groups who threaten individuals with violence. Now, we last considered this petition, colleagues, on the 21st of December, when we agreed to seek information from Police Scotland, the Scottish Police Authority, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. Police Scotland have provided further detail on Operation Soteria that was focused on tackling motorcycle thefts and related antisocial behaviour across Edinburgh. They also share information on the work the Police Prevention Interventions and Partnership Team are continuing to take forward in collaboration with others on this issue, which you will have read with interest. The Crown and Procurator Fiscal Service notes that there is no specific common law offence of theft for a motorcycle, but they have used their database to identify 47 charges related to motorcycle theft over the past 5 years. And interestingly, it also noted that 32% of the relevant police reports in relation to this originated from the Edinburgh area, where Operation Soteria obviously was in place. The Scottish Police Authority mentions in its response that recent reports highlight an overall increase in vehicle crime, but that this is not specifically attributed to motorcycle theft. The SPA also noted that over 1,800 motorcycle riders have been stopped over the past year to engage, educate and encourage what's described here, and I quote, as appropriate attitude and behaviours on the road. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Fergus Ewing.
Yes, could I suggest that we do write to the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service to seek information on the outcomes of the 47 prosecutions referenced in the response from the Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal Service? And in making that recommendation, I do so because I noted from the papers that there is reference to the fact that The particular instance of theft of motorcycles in Edinburgh has led to some advice being given to tourists not to visit Edinburgh. I think that's a particular concern, as well as, of course, theft is a serious matter anyway. But I think
motorcycles are just tourists generally. Sorry.
Advice, the notes we have indicates that advice has been given by some sort of tourist advisory group that riders should avoid travelling to Edinburgh. And I think that's quite a serious thing. None of us wish people to be deterred from visiting Scotland for reasons of that nature. So I think in order to explore, on deference to the petitioner, this to as far as we can, I think it'd be worth making that further effort because of the factor I've mentioned.
Thank you. Mr. Torrance, have you any comment to make?
No, none at all.
We're content with that. So are we content to support the writing just to establish what happened in relation to prosecutions? Excellent. Yes, Faisal Chowdhury.
Sure. Thank you. My apologies for coming in late because I was stuck in the car park.
Not on a motorcycle, I trust.
No. I had quite a lot of cases on motorcycle theft, and do you think we can ask the court if there is any, what's the waiting list of number of people who causes this crime are to be, to go to the court? I mean, if we can get that number, and how long is the waiting time? Because a lot of time that same person is coming back and doing the same incident regularly.
Well, I'm wondering who could, what would the best way to be to frame that question? So is that to the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service at the same time as we're inquiring after Mr. Ewing's suggestion would be to say, if they're able to give any indication of the current volume and kind of the waiting time associated with the bringing to proceedings any charges that might be underway. Agreed?
Yeah.
Thank you. That leads to the end of item two. We now move on to the consideration of our new petitions. And as I always do, in case there are those who are joining us online to look at our consideration of petitions, that ahead of the first consideration of the petition by the committee, we do seek to get an initial view from the Scottish Government and also from SPICE, which is the Scottish Parliament's Impartial Research Service. That doesn't necessarily determine the view of the committee, but it does mean that rather than us just go through the motions of suggesting that we then do that, that we have anticipated that that will be a course of action and therefore have that evidence already before us. And the first of the new petitions we're considering this morning is petition number 2003, and this has been lodged by Lewis McMartin. And the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to stop fast food chains from promoting unhealthy food choices by banning the use of reward systems. The Scottish Government's response outlines its current work to restrict the promotion of food and drink that is high in fat, sugar or salt. And when consulting on its planned legislation on this issue, promotional reward systems were not specifically consulted on, but it did remain open to views on whether such other types of promotions should be restricted beyond those set out in the consultation. The Scottish Government is currently considering responses to the consultation and will publish an external analysis report. Has the consultation then concluded, or is it? But it did remain open to views. So it's still open to views. So it's now closed. So it's too late to suggest the petitioner actually contribute to the consultation. I see. Right. Oh, so the petitioner is aware of that fact. But that's fine. Colleagues, I felt that the term fast food was rather loose in its definition. I know that there are now fast food salad bars. I mean, I wasn't quite sure if the petitioner had quite articulated who it was that he was specifically targeting here. But, colleagues, do we have any suggestions?
I would agree with that, Convener, because I do think that it's open to interpretation. and that creates some difficulties for us as to where and what the petition is trying to suggest here. So I would concur with what you're saying, but I'm not quite sure how we then take that forward if that is the case. Does that change any of the views that we might have when there's not that definition or that broad span that gives us the opportunity to look at that?
Yeah, I'm slightly unsure what to do. I mean, the Scottish Government said it's open to representations, but then that's not our responsibility in this regard. I mean, we could ask the Scottish Government what it thinks of all of that in practice, but that's not really, I think, taking matters forward. So I'm uncertain. I mean, I have to say, on this occasion, I'm minded to close the petition under Rule 15.7, but and I'm open to other suggestions from colleagues.
I think I would concur with that, Convener. I don't think we can look at it as the petitioners are suggesting. So under that circumstances, I would suggest that we do close it, because it is too wide and varied and doesn't give us the full opportunity.
I'm happy to support recommendations, Convener.
Fergus Ewan.
I think the issues involved are, although, as you stated, Convener, the wording of the petition is nebulous and vague, but nonetheless, the issues involved, I think, are almost certainly reserved to the UK government.
Yes. It's not that I don't see at the heart of all of this an issue, it's just I'm uncertain what productive opportunity there is for the committee to take the petition forward, and I think we are therefore reluctantly minded on this occasion to close the petition. We are agreed? Yeah. Petition number 2004 to abolish the use of public-private partnerships in Scotland, and this has been lodged by Line Kickenborg Christensen on behalf of Jubilee Scotland, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to abolish the use of public-private partnerships, PPPs, affectionately known, and to commit to a new model of financing and managing public infrastructure in Scotland, which has safety, quality, value for money and accountability to the taxpayer at its heart. The petitioners argue that public-private partnerships have left Scotland's public sector with high levels of debt, poor service provision, lack of accountability and unsafe buildings. In responding to the petition, the Scottish Government acknowledges the use of private finance for infrastructure projects is more expensive than conventional public borrowing and shares concerns around the flexibility and value of money for money offered by historic private finance initiative contracts. The Scottish Government has stated that as part of its national infrastructure mission commitment, a new approach to revenue finance, which includes the mutual investment model, has been announced. This follows a decision in 2019 to stop using the non-profit distributing model that was originally adopted in 2010. The government also highlights its view that current borrowing powers are limited and insufficient to deliver the ambitions of the National Infrastructure Mission, but should additional powers become available, it will examine all options to ensure the lowest cost financing route is utilised. Now, we've also received a submission from the petitioner offering comment on the Scottish Government's response with reference to Audit Scotland's 2020 report, Privately Financed Infrastructure Investment, the Non-Profit Distributing NPD and Hub Models. And the petitioner calls on the Scottish Government to act on Audit Scotland's recommendations and rethink the way infrastructure is managed and financed in Scotland. So, all quite technical, but nonetheless important and of considerable financial consequence. Do colleagues have any comments or suggestions as to how we might proceed? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I think the petition does make some valid points in reference to where we are in this whole situation, and it would be useful to write to the Scottish Government to seek some clarity at its response to the points made by the petitioner's submission. And to ask whether it has considered the Scottish Age Against Public-Private Partnership Task Force position paper and Financing Public Scotland, a proposal for an alternative to public-private partnerships, and if so, what its response is to some of these recommendations. Because, as you say, you know, it's complicated and complex, but if we get some clarity from the Scottish Government, that may give us an opportunity to investigate and get further information from them on that.
Thank you. Fergus Ewing.
I wonder whether, in addition to the action which Alexander Stewart suggested, with which I concur, we might wish to write to Scottish Futures Trust, because, as I understand it, their remit is very much of this nature and seek their views. And I would just add that the petitioner wants to abolish PPPs and create a new model, but it's simply not clear to me what that new model would be, because the statement of the new model is very much couched in abstract terms about what it should achieve, rather than describing exactly how it would operate in practice. But nonetheless, I think SFT do have great expertise in this area, so it would be useful to get their insights.
Happy to agree. Faisal Chowdhury.
Yeah, I do agree. They do make quite a lot of valid points, but I agree with Alexander and Fergus that we do need to come up with some proposals as well, how he wants to see us going.
OK, so are we agreed to write to the organisations as identified by Mr Stewart and Mr Ewing?
Yes.
We are. Thank you very much. So we can keep that petition open and proceed accordingly. Our next new petition is petition number 2005, which is a formal response to the annual adoption barometer report in Scotland, lodged by Jonathan Patrick, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to formally respond to the annual adoption barometer report, which is undertaken by Adoption UK. Now, the Scottish Government's response notes that it has recognised and welcomed the findings of the Adoption Barometer 2022 report, and additionally, Claire Hawkey MSP attended the formal launch of the report, and it was referred to in a members' business debate in March 23. The Scottish Government states that there are actually no plans to publish a formal written response to the report, which is consistent with its approach to previous publications of the annual adoption barometer reports and with the approach taken by other governments across the UK. So it appears the Scottish Government's procedural approach to this is consistent with other jurisdictions. Do members have any comments or suggestions? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government has welcomed, engaged with and referred to Adoption Barometer 2022 report, and has no plans to publish a formal written response to a report in line with previous publications and a UK-wide approach.
OK, well, in the light of that consistent approach across the UK and the actions as identified by David Torrance in his recommendation, are colleagues content that we don't pursue this petition any further? And close. We are. Thank you. And that brings us to the last of this morning's new petitions for us to consider. It's petition number 2006 to review and simplify the legislation in relation to dismissal of property factors. Forgive me, a slightly complicated introduction as I speak to this petition, which has been lodged by Ewan Miller. Property factors, to clarify a jargon term for the benefit of anybody listening in, manage the repair and maintenance of common property and communal areas in flats and housing estates on behalf of the homeowner's residents. Now, the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to amend the Property Factors Scotland Act to cover dismissal of property factors, or bring forward other regulations that would achieve the same aim. Now, this could include giving the first tier tribunal a free dispute resolution service, powers to resolve disputes related to the dismissal of property factors. Now, in his submission, the petitioner, as the chair of a local residents' association, explains his own experience of a struggle to dismiss their property factor. He argues that the legal framework around this process is complex and makes the dismissal of property factors unreasonably difficult. The Spice briefing explains that dismissal of property factors can indeed be a convoluted process, as relevant legislation is complicated and needs to be read in conjunction with the title deeds of a particular estate. There can also be complicated legal questions on whether conditions and title deeds are enforceable, and as a result, it may often be necessary to seek legal advice. Court actions may also be necessary if a dispute between homeowners and a property factor cannot be resolved, and of course that can all be quite an expensive consideration for those involved. The briefing notes various inquiries into the system over the years, particularly in relation to landowning maintenance companies, and these are property factors which own the land they maintain, normally open spaces and housing estates, and operate in a particularly large complex, in a particularly complex legal environment. Now, in 2013, the Scottish Government stated that doing nothing is not an option, given the concerns in this area, but at the same time it indicated a preference to prepare a voluntary code of practice on dismissing and replacing landowning maintenance companies rather than to legislate. However, this code is yet to be introduced, and on June the 22nd last, on June the 30th, 2022, Ash Regan, MSP, the then Minister for Community Safety, responded to a parliamentary question on the timeframe, saying that the government has prepared a draft code and is planning and seeking the views of stakeholders before it proceeds with publication. It should be noted that the new code is only intended to cover landowning factors. And with regards to non-landowning factors, the Scottish Government in its submission states that it has no plans to amend the legislation and highlights that the current regulations require factors to provide homeowners with clear information on the dismissal process. Now, I've got to say, this is, as a constituency MSP, is an issue I've come across myself, and I found the whole kind of business of it, you know, almost impenetrable. And it's also an extraordinarily difficult thing, even within residents' associations, within buildings dealing with factors, confronted sometimes with quite threatening suggestions of the costs for which they may then be liable, to be confident that they really can proceed. And I do wonder, given the periods over which this has been raised and the real comprehensive lack of progress at all, really, what colleagues think. Is anybody going to volunteer? David Torrance?
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee could write to the Scottish Government to seek an update on the voluntary code of practice on dismissing and replacing landowning land maintenance companies, in particular to ask what has been done since June 2022 to seek views on the draft code for customer-facing bodies and landowning land maintenance companies, and when the finalised voluntary code of practice will be published. I wonder, in addition to that, if we could write to relevant stakeholders, including the Property Management Association Scotland, Shelter Scotland, Under One Roof, and Citizens Advice Scotland, seeking their views on the petition.
I just wonder too, I mean, is there anybody, is there any body representative of homeowners rather than factors? Because when it says that there are current regulations that require factors to provide homeowners with clear information on the dismissal process, I mean, I really would like to know if there's anybody who can illustrate that that actually happens, because that sounds to me like one of these vague provisions that I suspect exists in writing but not in practice. But that's just from my own experience. Alexander Stewart?
I mean, I think you make a very valid point, Convener, because as you've already identified, there are areas within this that we already are aware of, but there are other organisations who participate or who may be involved in all of this that we don't have some information from. So I think that it would be useful just to see what is there when it comes to the factor side of things, and if there are areas that we could also incorporate. Because we've all suffered, and our constituents continue to suffer on this problem. And it is about trying to find out who's in control and who has the rights. And it can, as you indicate, become very costly for everybody. So I do think that we should try and find out if there's any other process that we can actually tap into.
I mean, I wonder if we could, in addition, when we write the Scottish Government, asking them on what basis they are satisfied that that regulation is being properly implemented, or how they would evidence the fact that that is the case. Fergus Ewing?
I mean, I certainly don't disagree with the approach that's been recommended, and inquiries should be made, but just to perhaps play the devil's advocate a little bit, I mean, my experience as a solicitor over many years is that whilst people don't necessarily enjoy paying factors' fees, the whole purpose of having a factor in a situation of a tenement of flats is to make sure that there is a system for carrying out common repairs, and if there is such a system, it needs to be paid for. Factors fees, in my experience, aren't particularly great, and in many ways being a factor is a bit of a thankless task, because the level of fees are generally not huge, and therefore there is a general I think there's a general public policy imperative that it is desirable that there should be a system normally set out in the title conditions, and usually very clearly set out in title conditions, for the appointment and removal of factors by a majority of owners. But the desirability of having a factor, I think, is very clear indeed. And indeed, if there is no factor, then the risks of major repairs not being done, and therefore things becoming much worse, is a very serious one. And I would have thought perhaps a rather more serious issue than the few cases where there may be concerns about overcharging or so on. So I just sort of say that to stick up for the humble factors who, in my experience, are in a bit of hiding to nothing very often and have to have, you know, eight people that can phone them at any time of the day demanding that action be taken immediately and all sorts of things. So I'm just playing the devil's advocate for a change.
Thank you, Mr. Ewing. I'm sure cups of coffee or something stronger have been raised in toast to your splendid defence. But I don't disagree with any of that. And I think that where good practice is in place, then all the positive attributes and advantages identified and everything you said there apply. It simply, I think, is in the circumstance where perhaps that is not the case, that residents find themselves in a very difficult position, not being entirely clear what it is they can do, and then finding quite difficult atmosphere can obtain trying to take matters forward. So with an understanding of the very valuable work that is nonetheless done, are we content to proceed on the basis that has been recommended? We are. Thank you all very much. And that brings us to the end of the public session this morning. We will be moving into private session to consider our public participation inquiry, and we'll meet again to consider petitions in open session on Wednesday the 17th of May. And on that basis, I move to private session.